Okay, why don't we begin, and let's begin with an announcement. You already know this because it's in the syllabus. We'll have an exam, the midterm exam in this class in 2 weeks, on March 19th, on Wednesday. Then right before that, on the Monday before, we'll have a review session in class just to kind of catch up. I'm not going to do a formal presentation that day, but I will be around to take, I will be here to take any questions that you might have that have cropped up in the course of your own reviewing. This is too much material. I'll try to go over all of it again in 50 minutes. In addition, on the course website on BSpace, there will be a narrative review in which I do kind of go systematically through the lectures and the material in the textbooks and point out the things that I think are important. That I've got to update because we've got a new edition of Fisk and Taylor this year, and I'll have that update soon. And as soon as it's posted, I'll let you know. The exam itself is going to cover everything we've covered so far from the very first lecture, the introductory lecture, through next Wednesday's lecture, the concluding lecture on social judgment and inference, and also the material in the corresponding chapters. It's going to look like about a 15-question short answer exam. I don't know if there's going to be 14 or 16, but it's going to be close to 15 questions. They'll be worth 3 to 5 points each for a total 50-point exam. What we're going to be asking you for are very, very, very short, pithy answers. None of the questions will require more than 3 to 5 sentences each. You just kind of blast right through these things, closer to 3 sentences. And you'll answer the exam questions right on the exam itself. We'll provide you with an exam with plenty of space, so you don't have to go off and purchase a blue book or anything like that. But we do want your answers written in ink, okay? That's so if there's a question about the scoring of any particular question, we know when the answer was written, okay? So please be prepared to write your answers in ink. And there's lots of material available for preparation. If you go to the exam information page on the BSpace website, you'll find a lot of material. You'll find first a little essay by me on my philosophy of exams and how we score exams and all of that. You'll find the narrative review as soon as I posted it. You'll also find all the old exams for this class, in addition to the scoring criteria that were given to the GSIs for grading the exams. Now, things change. I've used different textbooks over the years. We've got a new edition of Fisk and Taylor this year. Some material has dropped out of old lectures. Some material has come into old lectures. But those old exams will give you a good idea about what concepts and principles I think are particularly important and want to emphasize. The updated lecture illustrations. Lecture supplements include lecture material, but also go beyond it for those of you who are interested. But you're only responsible for what I cover here in these lectures and also what's in the assigned readings. You're not responsible for the extra material in the lecture supplements, but if you're really interested in the material, you may find them useful. In addition, we'll have a forum up on BSpace that's dedicated to questions before the midterm exam. Post your questions there. You'll get a response back from me within 24 hours. And the deadline for that is Tuesday, March 18th at noon. Any question posted to the BSpace forum by that date and time will get a response from me by the end of business that day. So that's kind of just another chance to get your questions answered. Any questions about the exam itself? Perfectly straightforward. It's just another midterm. Okay, when we talk about social interaction from a cognitive point of view, we can break down social cognition into a series of tasks that confront the social perceiver. We've already talked about two of these. One of these is impression formation, or person perception, drawing on our perceptual apparatus and on memory to form an impression of the person that we're dealing with, the situation in which we're dealing with that person, and whatever it is that's going on between the actor and the target in that situation. We also have to engage in social categorization. Remember, every act of perception is an act of categorization. From a cognitive point of view, perception is completed when you've categorized the object into some class of other objects that are familiar to you. That's essentially making a judgment of similarity. The third, and the topic for this series of lectures, is what's known as causal attribution, a process by which we try to explain what's going on in the world around us. That we do this in the non-social world as well as the social world. But basically what that means is taking the events that occur in the social environment and trying to figure out why they happened the way they did. And this basically boils down to trying to figure out what reasons would be sufficient to cause things to happen as they did. And then there's finally, kind of flows from this, a fourth task of the social perceiver, moral judgment, which if you think about it for a second, just doesn't apply in the non-social world. We don't make moral judgments about trees falling in the forest, and we don't even make moral judgments about tigers killing gazelles to eat, but we do make moral judgments about other people. So that when we attribute some event in the social world to a person as opposed to a situation, for example, we're going to make a moral judgment about that item. I'm not sure I'm going to have a chance to talk too much about moral judgment in these lectures, but I'm expanding the lecture supplements to cover moral judgment. So if you're really interested in that, I'll have some things to say about it there. But let's focus on causal attribution for the next couple of days, because very interesting things happen when you try to look at how people explain the events that occur in the social world. The foundation for all studies of causal attribution begins with our old friend Kurt Lewin, who you'll remember from an earlier set of lectures, who gave us this grand truism: behavior is a function of something about the person and something about the situation. Behavior occurs depending on features of the person and the situation. And that is basically a way for scientists to think about the causes of social behavior. But Lewin pointed out that that's also a way for the ordinary person walking around on the street to think about the causes of social behavior. So you've got some event, some behavior that occurs in the world. That behavior occurs as a function either of something about the person or something about the situation. This basic framework was adopted by another refugee from Hitler's Europe who came to the United States, Fritz Haider, who devoted himself to social perception and social cognition in a way that Lewin really didn't. But he took Lewin's basic formula here, B is a function of P and D, and said, well, look, when people try to figure out why something happened, they apply something very much like this formula, which they understand intuitively. They figure that there are basically two possible causes of behavior, something about the person, the actor who engaged in the behavior, or something about the environment, the situation in which the behavior occurred. Haider was also very careful to distinguish between the actual and perceived causes of behavior. He said it's the job of the scientist to figure out why something something really happened the way it really did, okay? That's analyzing the actual causes of behavior. But the ordinary person on the street isn't doing that. What we want to know about the ordinary person on the street is, what does he perceive the cause of behavior to be? Because it's that perception of the cause of behavior that's going to determine how he's going to respond, what he's going to do next, and so on. Remember that the situation, including the cause of what goes on in the situation, that's important, is the perceived situation. So there's a distinction here between what you might call the professional psychologist, people who are paid to conduct psychological research, if you will. We're interested in the actual causes of behavior, but the naive psychologist, as Lewin and Heider would have called him, we're really concerned with the perceived causes of behavior. And Heider argued that studies of causal attribution always want to understand causal attribution from the person's point of view, okay? However it is that he or she determines what the cause of behavior is, that's what we want to be interested in. Okay, so now given this basic formula here, behavior is a function of the person and the environment, a whole tradition in social psychology grew up around this. And it basically generates a kind of model, even a calculus, you could call it, for assigning causality to social events. The person responsible for this very, very, very popular model, traditional model for causal attribution, is Harold Kelly, longtime professor of psychology at UCLA. And he based his ideas about how ordinary people on the street make causal attributions on the statistical models or the statistical methods that professional scientists use when they make causal attributions. So for those of you who have had your introductory statistics course, which I hope most of you have had by now, we're talking here about modeling the naive psychologist causal attributions on something that professional psychologists use every day, the analysis of variance. And what that Kelly argued was that over multiple observations of behavior, we abstract from those multiple observations a set of a fund of information, a body of information that allows us to partition the variance in behavior into its principal causes, either the actor, which you can think of as a main effect, or the target of the action, or the context in which the action takes place. Or, if you really want to be fancy, you can also add in joint causes, what are known in the analysis of variance as interaction effects. So something about the particular combination of the actor and the target, or something about the particular combination of the target and the context, or the actor and the context, or if you really want to get complicated, the particular blending of a single actor, a single target, and a single context. Kelly argued that if you had multiple observations of behavior, if you had enough multiple observations of behavior, you could use something very much like the statistical analysis of variance to identify why something happened the way it did. Let me give you some examples here of how it's supposed to work. So, for example, Kelly argued that from multiple observations of behavior, we extracted three kinds of information that, when fed into the covariation calculus, will tell us why things happened the way they did. The first of these is what's known as what he called consistency, by which he meant consistency of the actor's behavior toward a particular actor's behavior toward a particular target across multiple contexts, okay? So you've got high consistency, where the actor always behaves the same way towards the target, no matter what the context is, or low consistency, where the actor's behavior towards the target varies from one situation to another, okay? Same idea here, the distinctiveness of the actor's behavior across targets holding the context constant. So, for example, if an actor behaves toward a particular target in a context one way and other targets in another way, that would be high distinctiveness, okay? The actor's behavior towards the target is highly distinctive compared to the actor's behavior towards other targets. Or low distinctiveness, the actor behaves towards all targets in the same way, okay? He doesn't distinguish between one target and another. And then finally, consensus, meaning the consensus of actors, multiple actors, towards a single target. So the consensus among actors in their behavior towards a target in a particular context. High consensus means that everybody behaves the same way towards the target in that context. Low consensus means there's a lot of variability across actors in their behavior towards a particular target. Now notice, again, think about the analysis of variance for a second. What's happening here? Consistency across context, you've got the actor you're holding constant, the target you're holding constant, and the context you're varying. With distinctiveness across targets, you're keeping the actor constant, you're keeping the context constant, and you're varying the targets. And finally, with consensus, you're keeping the target constant and the context constant, but you're varying the actors. Varying one variable while holding all other variables constant is the essence of the experimental method. And what Kelly argued was that in the ordinary course of everyday living, we do something very much like this. We try to see what variability occurs when all other factors are held constant. Quick question. I'm going to give you lots of examples, okay? That's exactly what I'm going to do. Because if you think about this for a second, you got three different kinds of information, consistency, distinctiveness, and consensus. You got two levels of information, high versus low. There are basically eight possible combinations of information that you could extract from multiple observations of behavior. Example number one, here's a naive experiment, okay? What we're going to do, again, just what Kelly says we do, we're going to vary one cause and keep the others constant, okay? And what we're talking about here is phenomenal cause. That is, the causes that we perceive through our mental apparatus, not some objective cause that might be determined by some other method. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this particular behavior, John laughed at the comedian, okay? The behavior is laughing. The actor is John. The target is the comedian, and the context is presumably some performance. John's gone to a nightclub, or he's watching the Ed Sullivan Show, or Saturday Night Live, or something like that, and he's laughing at the comedian. And what we want to know is, why is John doing that? Okay, why did John laugh at the comedian? Okay, let's try to figure it out. Okay, so first, it could be something about John. Maybe John's a kind of manic-y type, and he just laughs at everything. Okay, or it could be something about the comedian. Maybe that comedian is so funny, he could make Adolf Hitler laugh. Okay, or maybe it's something about the situation. It's a nightclub, people are drinking, and so on and so forth, and you know, everybody just kind of gets giggly. Or it might be something about John and the comedian, for example, that John laughed at the comedian because he really likes John Stewart, okay, or whatever it is. This would be an interaction where both John and the comedian are necessary causes. It has to be John, not Joe or Gene. It has to be John Stewart, not Andy Kaufman or somebody else. Neither cause is sufficient to get laughter, but when you put them together, John and the comedian, you get them together. That would be what an interaction would look like. So now let's see how this works out in more detail. This is this part of the lecture is based on a doctoral dissertation by Leslie MacArthur, now Leslie Zebrowitz. I've introduced her to you before, who was the first to take Kelly's covariation calculus and actually try to test it empirically. Okay, so we got an event. Okay, John laughed at the comedian. And what MacArthur did was to vary consensus, consistency, and distinctiveness information across multiple trials. There's just a questionnaire in which she laid out these scenarios. So to vary consensus information, she says John laughed at the comedian. Almost everyone who heard the comedian laughed at him. Okay, that's high consensus. Or hardly anyone who heard the comedian laughed at him. That's low consensus. Or she varied the consistency information. In the past, John has almost always laughed at this comedian. John's behavior towards the comedian is highly consistent. Or in the past, John has hardly ever laughed at the comedian. So there's low consistency. He laughed at him this time, but not other times. Or she varied distinctiveness information. John rarely laughs at other comedians. That's highly distinctive. He only laughs at Andy Kaufman, okay? Or John almost always laughs at other comedians. That low distinctiveness information. John's very indiscriminate in his laughter. And then there were also control observation questions where MacArthur provided the subjects with no consensus, consistency, or distinctiveness information. So long questionnaire, lots of scenarios, all of which systematically varied the consensus, consistency, and distinctiveness information available to subjects. And then she simply asked them to figure out why the event happened. So she gave them four choices. Was it something about the actor? Something about John? Was it something about the target, something about that comedian, something about the circumstances, the general situation, or some combination of causes? Now, of course, you could do a more detailed inquiry. You can ask about all those interactions and all of that. She didn't do that. She had to get her dissertation done, right? That's not a criticism. Everybody's got to get their dissertation done. And she also didn't want to complicate the thing too much, because we're really interested in these attributions to the actor, to the target, or to the situation. So here's a good example. John laughed at the comedian. Consistency is high. In the past, John has almost always laughed at this comedian. Distinctiveness is low. John also laughs at other comedians. And consensus is low. Hardly anyone else laughed at this comedian. So why did John laugh at the comedian? Yeah, something about John, right? You make the causal attribution to the actor because he's the only one doing this, right? That's the idea behind the calculus. And in fact, when MacArthur did her study, she found that particular combination of high consistency, low distinctiveness, and low consensus drove attributions to the actor just exactly the way the model predicts it would. When people are presented with that pattern of information, then they make attributions toward the actor. Let's do another example, case two. John laughed at the comedian, okay? Now we're gonna keep consistency high. In the past, John has almost always laughed at this comedian, but now we're gonna elevate distinctiveness. We're gonna make distinctiveness high. John doesn't laugh at other comedians, okay? He only laughed at this one. But now we're also gonna make consensus also high. Everyone laughed at this comedian. Under those circumstances, with high consistency, high distinctiveness, and high consensus, okay, then the attribution is to the comedian, right? He's a particularly funny guy. He makes John laugh at him, and everybody else laughs at him too, okay? There's something about this comedian. He's very good or very whatever comedians are. And what MacArthur discovered was that's exactly what happened in her experiment. High consistency, high distinctiveness, and high consensus drove attributions toward the target, okay, in a way that this didn't occur with other combinations of information. One more. Case three, John laughed at the comedian. Now let's make consistency low again. In the past, John has almost never laughed at this comedian. We'll keep distinctiveness high. John doesn't laugh at other comedians, okay? And we're gonna keep consensus also high. Everyone laughed at this comedian. Under those circumstances, with low consistency on John's behavior, high distinctiveness, okay, and high consensus, what is it? How did this thing happen? Logically, you would drive the attribution towards the context, towards the situation. Everybody's drunk, or everybody's high, or everybody's something. So they're all laughing wildly at this comedian. It's something that John wouldn't ordinarily do. And, of course, I wouldn't be showing you this if it weren't the case. That's exactly what happens, okay? So here we have low consistency, high distinctiveness, and low consensus. And what you've got here is an attribution is driven towards the circumstances, or the attribution. Oh, he did it because, for the same reason everybody else did it, they were all drunk, or something like that. It's not something that's attributable to the actor exactly, and it's certainly not attributable to the target. It's got to be attributable to the situation. Okay, so that's how the covariation calculus works. You look at covariation. You look at what factors, what kinds of causes are varied, co-vary with the outcome. Does the outcome vary with the actor? Does it vary with the target? Does it vary with the situation? Does it vary with some combination of actor, target, and the situation? And what you get is what Roger Brown has called the covariation calculus, because it's a calculus. It's a method of computation here, where you've got various combinations of consistency, distinctiveness, and consensus information. And for each of these combinations of information, each of these combinations will drive attributions toward a particular cause, the actor, the target, the context, or in this particular case, didn't want to throw them all up here, the actor and the target in combination. So, for example, John really likes Andy Kaufman. He always laughs at him even when Andy Kaufman's having a bad night, which he's having now, because he's dead. Okay, so if you think about this for a second, the covariation calculus being explicitly based on the statistical analysis of variance is a completely rational way to think about how to figure out cause. That's what the analysis of variance is. That's why professional scientists use the analysis of variance, because it's an algorithm that allows you to figure these things out. So again, what you've got here is this idea of the person behaving much the same way a professional scientist would do. But most people aren't professional scientists, but somehow they pick up on how to do this. They're naive scientists. They engage in something like a controlled experiment. Now, we can't actually pick up an audience and deposit it first in front of Andy Kaufman and then in front of Mort Saul or somebody like that. But what we do is we do something